This is Kate Baconsale. You're listening to Baconsale.
Feeling all right today, it's almost season 8. Sending our love to you today, we're taking a tiny break. We're gonna live and let die today, Crowbar Poll gives bad grades. We follow spoiler law today, 5, 6, 7, and 8. And our athletes put on their Speedos.
Celia.
Snow White sings whistle while you work it. Zack's license to give you a haircut.
Hey,
it's Subway every day for lunch. Now we are scheming to plan a bank heist. Talking rom-coms for Valentine's.
Of course.
Matt's can't get enough of me dying. Don't stop me now, we're having a good time. Up all. It's season 7. Went pretty well.
Okay.
It's season 7. Here on Baconsale.
Yeah!
Baconsale!
Baconsale!
One take!
Oh, yeah,
one take!
I did it, guys.
One take!
Good job, Kent.
What's that instrument called again?
Vibra slap.
Oh, yeah, that's
it. Wow, thank you, Kent, for that slice of cake that we got.
Yeah,
you're welcome. Appreciate that. Welcome to Baconsale. I'm Joel.
I'm Kent.
And I'm Zack.
I'd like to thank you for, speaking of cake, we'd like to thank you for listening to our last show, our Christmas treats show.
I'm going to be very sincere. I almost forgot my name just now.
You're just so excited about cake.
That's how good it was.
Yeah, it was a really fun show, and I honestly think we might have gotten our most engagement ever.
What?
Stop it.
Yeah.
It was, no, maybe not ever, but it was awesome.
No, stop it.
Sam Ma commented on Facebook, food tiering shows are my favorite. Capital letters there. And this did not disappoint. Great work, guys. Kent Dunn, you should officially change your name to Kent Pun.
Oh, I kind
of
love it.
Speaking of Kent Pun, I would like to shout out and give a big thank you to Drew Cutler, Crew Dutler on Twitter, who he does the drunk train. If you haven't seen this before, he'll slow down episodes of Baconsale. And
it makes it sound real bad.
It's pretty hilarious. But he took all of Kent's I'll give you the gift of this treat puns and slowed them down onto the drunk train.
It's 7 minutes of us slurring.
It's an obnoxious 7 minutes of hilarity.
Yes.
And it cracked me up. Like, it really, that was a lot of fun to do. Speaking of cracking, I don't know if you're going to bring this up or not, Zack, but was it Spencer Larson, the listener, who did the picture of Kent writing his puns?
And it was so funny.
And it was Ralphie from Christmas Story, looking so pleased, and I died.
I had a sense of pride as I was writing the puns.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh man, that cracked me up so much.
And then just finally, Mandy Sue Sparkle on Instagram said, "So many strong opinions, so many wrong opinions."
Baconsale.
Really is. We could be our tagline forever.
Probably should be.
Yeah,
but that's not what we're talking about today. What are we talking about today, Zack?
A
little somber tone there.
We are talking our season 7 in general, for it is our season 7 finale.
Yes, we are ending season 7. We are going to be taking a break for a couple weeks. We'll be back in January. Don't worry.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to be retooling some stuff and working some stuff and improving ourselves, making some changes on Patreon to our
improving ourselves. Like, is that a goal?
I might just push up.
I don't know about that. Do I have to work out? No.
No, but at the same time, I might do a push-up between now and
one push-up.
No. I'm not making any promises.
Yeah, we're working on some things, adjusting some things. Like you said, I'm really going to try hard during this break to make some video Patreon content happen.
And if you're not following us on Patreon, if you're not a patron of Baconsale, you should know that even though we're taking a break here on the main podcast feed, we'll be doing stuff on Patreon probably
Planning next year.
Yes, we will.
If we survive how things are going to go in this show.
Yeah, we kind of have a tendency that things end weird at the end of season.
A little bit. Yeah, but then Kent walks out dating whatever happened.
That's a quotable quote. Anyways, segue right into a new patron, you guys.
New patron!
So guys, guess what?
What?
It's Chase Hemingway.
Chase Hemingway.
We actually have a message here. It's from his dad. He says, Merry Christmas, Chase Hemingway. 1 year of being a Baconsale patron from dad. So he gifted him 1 year of patronage.
You can give the gift of Patreon?
Yes.
Wow,
but then
so cool.
Tim continues this, Kent.
keep it family friendly in 2022 for my kid. I can't promise anything. In fact, I've met Chase. I feel like it's time for him to mature, grow up a little bit.
No.
I think, you know, maybe he'll learn to swear.
No. Well, not on Baconsale.
Not on Baconsale. But yeah, Chase, welcome. You're great. And honestly, I feel like Chase is probably our youngest listener, and he's even got a few of his friends to listen as well.
That's awesome. And,
nice.
And now that I was going to say, now that he's a $3 patron, he has access to all the Bacon bits that we've done.
No swears.
And we've done a lot.
That's like
124, I think.
If Baconsale is G, then the Bacon bits are PG
for a Bacon bit.
You think so?
Guaranteed.
I think so. They get a little spicy,
like a mild packet of Taco Bell sauce. Is that what you're saying?
I literally talk about Taco Bell. So
that's what you do.
Yeah.
Yeah. But then, Chase, welcome as a patron. Merry Christmas to you. But let's jump into it, shall we, gentlemen?
So we're just giving ourselves a big pat on the back, huh?
Yes. Yes. A little bit. This is very self-indulgent.
I think I may have said this last year. If this is the first episode that you've ever listened to of Baconsale, don't.
Yeah. You said that on
Ask Baconsale.
Yeah, pick something else.
This is basically Baconception.
Yeah.
Like, this is just us being like, let's look back at us.
Because it's like the end of the year. We like to look back at what we did. And then it's kind of a gimme show here at the end during the busy holiday season. So we can be like, okay, let's take a break. Let's talk some stats, though.
Okay, yeah, let's hear it.
For example, how many guests do you think we had on this season of Baconsale?
11.
Ooh. 13.
What? Oh, wow.
I was going to say 10.
We had Matts on The Hunger Games, Brian Mattson on Horror Pitches, Pumpkin Spices Life, Tim Behunin, a Beaker on Haunted Places, Nicole DeHale on Stephen King and Godzilla Show, Chris Anderson on Disney Princess and Godzilla. We had Jessica Terry do The Grimm with Zach's pronunciations of all the different creatures.
It's so
there.
Good.
We had Braden Winterton do the TV series show. We had Terry Finley doing the commercial jingles. We had Ryan Farron doing the movie set in the future. Spencer Larson, Scott Mackey, and Brandon Gehrig were all in our 300th episode as contestants.
Wow.
And we had Stephen Ross doing the Dresden Files.
Holy cow.
A lot of different voices here on Baconsale, a lot of different subjects, and we had a lot of fun with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So, our longest episode.
Yes.
You guys want to guess our longest episode of season 7?
I know the answer, but I'll happily guess.
It's usually a bracket show. I'm going to say 70s part 1.
70s bands part 1.
Yes.
It was actually...
Third place.
Yeah, third place. Because number 1 is episode 308, We Ate Everything at Subway.
Oh, yeah.
1 hour and 51 minutes
long. Oh.
Once again, not our longest episode.
I love that episode was the one that no one wanted to eat at the fast food place after.
Flip it over to the shortest episode.
Point of order. I believe there might be one longer than that.
What?
Yes. Have you checked the time of episode 326, The Haunting of Baconsale House? It is 1 hour, 50 minutes, and 53 seconds. I think it's ever so slightly longer.
I think they're about tied then.
We had two super long episodes. This is a controversial episode already.
Yeah.
Well, let's have a bracket.
Let's talk about the shortest episode. Shortest episode, Kent?
I should know. It was a recent one. I don't remember, though.
It was not a recent one. It was episode 305, The Great Podcast Caper.
Oh, yeah.
1 hour and 2 minutes.
Super brisk.
That's the kind of tight hour I want on Baconsale. Yeah.
How many pages of notes do you usually have?
Just checking. Many.
The fact that it happened once... That's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is funny because 1 hour and 2 minutes is only 7 minutes longer than our longest Bacon bit, which was the Snyder Cut review.
Oh. Sorry about that.
It was basically a full episode, Kent. We did 16 Bacon bits. We did 44 Bacon bits, including the one that just barely aired.
I don't want to know the time on the Bacon bits, but they're long and it's my fault.
They're very long.
Yep.
5 uncut episodes. And are you guys ready? Zach, you probably have the top 3 most listened episodes. I have the 1.
I have the top. Yeah. Well, I'll give you time real quick. Time average this season. Time average for the episodes. I'm sorry, guys. It went up. So last year, from
season 6?
Last year it was 86.5 minutes. The year prior it was 82. That was 82. The average?
Yeah. Yeah, so 82 to 86.
So this is an hour 22 minutes, an hour 26 and a half minutes last year.
Oh, no.
It was an hour 27.9.
We are
so good at making hour and a half.
And you want it to be shorter. Is that what you said?
We're trying to get a tighter show in here, you know? It's a quick, easy listen to on the...
Don't know how.
There was, however, a nice offset to the Snyder Cut. I believe we have our shortest Bacon bit ever. The team listener versus team JK.
That's right.
It was nine minutes long.
Yeah.
And
because we made swift work of them. Yeah. Let's be honest.
So the average Bacon bit was 29 minutes.
Go team JK.
All right.
And then, Zach, you want to talk about the most listened episodes? You want to do the top 3 there?
You know, these ones honestly surprised me and bothered me a little bit because I'm not on one of them. Okay. So the top 3 from the third one, It's Queen Will Rock You.
That was our third highest most listened episode.
Yes, episode 306. Then episode 320, Ranking Disney Princes.
Yeah.
That one coming
Disney,
in high.
Disney ones are popular. Yeah. Although we did Disney songs this year. I was surprised that one wouldn't go further.
So, I mean, that one makes sense, Disney. The number one, though, drum roll here. Episode 316, Chicken Sandwich, War and Peace.
Oh.
With Jacob.
Wasn't on that one.
But it was a food one.
I have.
It was a challenge one. It was a food one.
Nope.
It was Chicken Sandwich Wars are popular, Zach.
It proves it.
Yeah.
I'm glad you guys did it. Actually, I'm thankful I didn't participate in this challenge.
Why?
Saved a lot of calories.
Yeah, that's true.
Says but it was also delicious. Like four chocolates and a giant burrito tonight.
I never eat on the show, Joel.
Lies. Uh-huh. Lies. Oops. You do. So, yes, there's some fun stats about the past season. We find them fun. Hopefully you do as well. But let's jump into it, shall we? It's a category show.
It's a classic
about
Baconsale category show.
This is us talking about us.
The research was just us. I love us.
I'm glad you do.
Yeah. So, Zach, get us started with some categories.
Well, our first category, and a reminder, we have a rule here for category shows. If you use it once, then that's all you can do.
Yeah.
Except for on this show, we always break the rule.
Yeah, we do.
Because there's two categories at the end that are like all-encompassing.
I've always seen it more of a guideline than a rule.
Yeah, all right. Number one, of course, we have to start with the intro of the show. So what's your favorite intro or outro of 2021?
So I picked one, and once again, there was a lot to choose from. You guys really, really brought it this year. And
I think we may have stepped up
this year. I did go through, by the way. I listened to every single intro up to the point where, say, what are we talking about today, Zach?
Okay.
And then I listened to every single outro for the past season in the last couple of days. It's been a binge listen. It's been a lot of fun.
You've heard a lot of the beginning
I
of
have.
The show.
And the ending, where it recaps everything that most everything that happened.
Yeah.
But I said my favorite intro or outro was episode 290, Moving Right Along with the Muppets.
Oh, so good.
Boy,
Muppet intro, we did it in two takes.
Two takes.
It was two takes, and we kind of spliced them together.
Yep.
And it was just us.
I could have used a third.
You think so? Because I'll tell you
it would have got better.
Just for the end.
That's one of those intros, though, that I...
are you going to play the clip?
No. Okay, I don't have it. You can go back and listen to episode 290. Yeah. But that was one where I listened to it over and over and over again, like, repeatedly, because it made me laugh so hard, because it sounds like this room full of Muppets, and it's just us doing different voices.
Your Kermit voice is great.
Oh, thank you.
All of it. It's time to...
Yeah. Well, and then we also, for like four episodes after, we kept being like, yeah!
We raise our hands.
I played that intro so many times for my daughters, and they just look at me like, Dad, this is your podcast? This is what you do? I'm like, yeah, it's awesome.
Well, but here's the funny thing, too, is when we did that episode, the Muppet Show was about to come to Disney Plus.
Yeah.
My kids kind of knew that song, but not really. We've since watched almost the entire first season of Muppets together. And when I was playing this in my room, my daughter poked her head in and she started singing along. And then it was the wrong words because it was our version.
Oh.
She's like, what's this?
Fantastic.
And I was like, you know the song. So proud dad moment and a great moment, I think, for Baconsale. We had a lot of fun doing it. So yeah, that's what I said.
Definitely a highlight of the year. Kent?
All right, I'm going to play mine. And I want you guys to listen to the entire thing. It deserves your ears.
Uh-oh.
Is this the intro?
Oh, no.
Yes.
It's a minute long, so bear with us.
Well, and this is all Zach. He pre-recorded all this, and he came to us and he's like, "Hey guys, I have this thing we're doing." And this is the one where we kind of talked about on the show.
Mm-hmm.
You and I were kind of writing an intro,
yeah.
And then we're like, "Oh, it's Zach's turn," and so we threw it to him like, "Good luck." And then he pulls this out,
yeah. And we generally don't pre-record anything,
no.
But when you layer how many layers,
like 13,
it's like 13 Zachs. Well, I think 12 Zachs, and I did sing one on the night.
You did. You said to me at the end of this. You say it.
Yeah. In fact, I included it here.
Just the left and right audio there, which I thought was really cool.
Yeah, I did because it. Of
and
course
here we are talking over this wonderful piece.
Well, if they want to hear it, they can listen to the episode.
Okay. Here we go. And ready?
Here's the live part. Zach coming live. So pure.
So pure, Zach.
Yeah. This one stressed me out. And as my wife pointed out, I have this issue, and it happens a couple times throughout the season, where I refuse to change the key that these professional singers have sung in. It also happened in, I sang Aerosmith, I think, at one point.
You did.
It's like, why do I sing so high? I don't need to. And that was another one where I'm like, this is a bad choice, but here we go.
It's magic.
Well, here's the thing. On Baconsale, I mean, Zach, you do sing very well.
I'm fine.
But the comedy definitely comes from us not singing well.
Yeah.
And so being able to try to hit those high notes that you can't hit is like, humorous.
You save us.
But I was going to say, you are the most professional singer of anyone here.
I'm fine. But it was fun to really put that together.
And I would have picked that, but I saved that.
Okay, and I hear you there. But for an episode as epic as that Queen show was, as special as that is to our hearts, Zack, you really just introduced in the best possible way.
I also liked at the ending how we were trying to do the harmony of "Any Way the Wind Blows," and we couldn't get it together. Nope. So I'm like, just sing it one person.
Yeah,
All right, so Zack, what'd you choose?
I chose, and I struggle with this because I
favorite intro.
Do have a recency bias.
You can choose your own too, by the way.
And I'm not going to choose my own.
Okay.
But before I get I'm going to give you the little Zack attack that I have. I reached out to my Baconsale Brain Trust, which is definitely my wife and my mom, and I asked them all of these categories. So just want to give the quick honorable mention of what they said. They said "Moving Right Along" with the Muppets. Both of them did. There was a shout out to Twinner Winner song titles.
Oh, that was the hello.
That was the hello. That,
yeah.
All the hellos. And then my wife also said Queen. But my choice, and this is very much a Zack choice, it's a recent episode number 329, Bonding with James, Part 1.
Okay.
Where Kent sang Boop Finger.
Boop Finger.
I love it. This Goldfinger is ingrained in my soul. I know this song very well. I sing it all the time. I make fun of it all
Zack,
the time.
Have I ruined this song for you?
You have improved it substantially, and I already loved it. I will be in traffic and just sing Boop Finger. It's one of my favorite intros ever.
Touch.
I specifically said, I think on that show, well, I'm going to talk about that later in the season.
Yeah, you did.
And I was right. I went back and also, Joel, I listened to every intro and every quote at the end of every episode. Mm-hmm. And I just, as soon as Boop Finger was there, I got so happy. So thank you for appealing to
for ruining Shirley Bassey.
Kenty Bassey.
Kenty Bassey.
Oh, no, I hate that so much.
Birthing Kenty Bassey. That sounds weird.
please don't. All right, next up we have most nostalgic episode.
I went with See You in the Funny Papers.
Yeah.
Comic strip episode.
302. Yeah.
This was full nostalgia, and it was so much fun. I mean, not only was the research good because you go back and read comic strips that I probably haven't read in, I don't know, 30 years.
I actually did end up following Pickles and Zitz. On,
but not Foxtrot.
No, it was Foxtrot. It was Pickles and Foxtrot on Instagram, and so their comics come out now. I'm like, that's right, these are so fun.
And it was so hard because on some category shows, even this one, it's like, which darling do I want to promote to this spot? Yeah. And it was so hard because going through that full page and a half of newspaper to being like, what were my favorites?
Yeah,
what was the Doonesbury? Like, how much did I hate that one? Beetle Bailey, Sherman's Lagoon, Calvin and Hobbes. We talk about these legendary comic strips that maybe we could probably never do a part two because we just covered all the classics.
I think we could do a part two.
You think so?
I think so. I mean, Zack didn't know any of the ones we talked about the first time. He's not going to know any of the ones we talked about the second time.
And I'm giving you a blank stare right now.
But it was so fun because, well, sometimes we just do shows where we're like, we hope people can relate. And somehow people really did.
And that was one where I was worried. Like, I'm like, this is very niche. Mm-hmm. Like, but then the listener came out in droves and was like, you know, you forgot this one, you jerks. They're so caring. But
Joel, you reciting or acting out the comic strip panels really didn't work in a podcast, but made me laugh so hard.
We got such a kick out of trying to explain comedy, and I think that's one of the things that made the show funny. But I think I definitely agree with you, Kent. I think we hit a nostalgia nerve there with the listener because we got a lot of them commenting about their favorite comics. So
right.
Kent, my wife agrees with you.
Okay.
Yeah. She also picked one.
Yes.
But I actually agree with my mom. So I obviously didn't.
You should probably agree with your wife, not your mom. Just letting you know.
I don't really read these comics, right? I didn't know these, but I see why so many people got that one. But for me, it was episode 288, Tabletop of the World. We have now done two kind of board games or board game type shows. Last season, it was Do You Even Hasbro? And I just love them every time. Thinking about these games, and I only ever played them when I was little. I don't really play too many games anymore. And just thinking back to the good times and random games that you played, it is always fun to look back.
Well, and
those have done well.
I mean, I just played Battleship the other day with my son and had a blast doing that. And it's just one of the games are fun and being able to talk about
him.
I squashed him.
Wonderful.
I put all of them on the sides. Like, they were just lining my boats were lining the sides. He had no
chance.
What
a good strategy. Now he knows, though.
Yeah, now he knows that I did that.
What about you, Joel?
For me, it was episode 321, Live in Concert.
Yeah.
So this was our concert category show. And for me, very personally, like, I keep a pretty regular journal.
Do you keep your tickets?
I do. And so I would go back and like look through my journals and find the ticket stub, and I'd find the date, and I'd read about the concert and what I thought about it. And it was such a nostalgic wave. Like I was going through journal after journal, just finding these concerts. And then being able, you showed me a site where I could find the exact date where it happened.
Yeah, wasn't that cool?
So then I could go find it in my journal and see what I said about it. And your disturbing story haunted me for a long
about
time.
About the eyeballs?
Yes. And then it was also funny because like one of the things I loved about it is like, you know, we're just sitting there talking about us. This is like, hey, this is us. This is our experience.
Yeah.
But people in the comments were just like, I was at that concert too.
It was great.
Oh, I saw these guys in concert. They were amazing.
Yeah, I got jealous of so many people.
I know. They're like, oh, I saw this person. I'm like, oh, I'd love to see them. A couple different people said they were also at the Goldfinger concert that we talked about. And they were like, oh, yeah, I saw that. That was gross.
Yeah.
And then I had a bunch of people like writing me privately. Just
yeah,
like,
just because you don't want to say it out loud.
What happened?
Right.
I'm like, I'll tell you privately. I'm not going to say it here on the concert. But yeah, live in concert, I really did enjoy. And it was just wave after wave of nostalgia, just remembering all these good concerts I went to. And it made me want to go to more concerts.
Yeah, which we probably will this coming year.
I hope to.
All right, next up we have favorite cover arts. And I'll start on this one. I got to give the shout out to the Brain Trust. My wife liked The Tabletop of the World. So Kent built...
That one is kind of obscured, right?
It's a Monopoly board.
It just looks like a Monopoly board.
Kate Beckinsale wearing a monocle.
But you, every single space
is an Easter egg.
Something Easter eggy about Baconsale. It's so clever.
Yeah.
But it's so simple. And I love that one.
And can you do that a lot where you'll throw a lot of Easter eggs in a picture and hoping that someone will notice.
Yeah.
And every now and then we'll get a ping from Kent on Messenger's like,
Nobody noticed the Easter egg on Ghostbusters Afterlife.
Look in the bottom right quadrant.
You won't even say that. You'll say, no one noticed my Easter egg. And Zach I will go there and be like, who can find it first? Who can find it first?
Yeah.
So
you ruined Christmas. And then I have to call out how biased my mom is. She decided that the Choose Your Own Adventure Hunger Games art was one of her favorites because I'm in it with my wife.
Looking and awesome.
Yeah, where I was going to say, that's the first time I think my wife's face has ever been featured on Baconsale.
Yeah, yeah, that's true.
She was hesitant, but okay with
it. By the way, Joel, you were PETA and Katniss.
Oh,
obviously.
Nice. Yeah. Nice.
Who was I?
You were a very strong
Rando.
Character.
Yeah, Rando.
Yeah, we were randos, let's be honest.
And then my mom also called out episode 313 Canadian Baconsale. I'm like, Mom, that's the only one I did this year.
And she knew that, right?
Yeah, she created that, art.
Yeah, but my favorite is the only one that we all set as our profile pictures this year. That is episode 290, moving right along with Muppets.
When Kent made us into Muppets.
Kent made us into Muppets. Yeah! So I just thought it was so cool to be a Muppet. I think, I can't remember who commented it, but... somebody said that I'm basically Guy Smiley.
Yep. With, you are.
Well, Kent was also very kind of being like, okay, what color of fur do you want?
Yeah. He let us pick our colors.
He let us kind of, you know, design our like he came up with it and like we'd ask his question. But Kent has this weird knack.
Go on.
Of being able to put our likeness on things that's not us.
It's all in the hair.
That's what he said.
It's all in the hair. And the eyebrows.
Yes.
Because Joel, you have slightly smaller eyebrows and they kind of point up because you're nice all the time. I've got the
point up. That sounds like I'm evil.
You got the point up. No, like up, like the raised down.
Eyebrows. Yeah.
You always have one eyebrow up, Kent.
Yes, I've got the smolder eyebrows going on.
And it usually works. Kent, Zach usually has a beard. Kent has stubble, and I'm clean shaven. Yeah. Yes. Even though right now, Zach and I have full beards, and Kent has the stubble.
Oh, yeah. Well, even last week is gingerbread cookies. Adorable.
That's the other thing, too, is on the Hunger Games picture, that was the episode we did a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
I had a beard then, but Kent just pulled from his random stock photos of history database. Of me, and he's like, I need a picture of Joel looking serious. Boom.
You looked really handsome.
And I was clean shaven in that picture.
Yeah, you look great.
Thank you. I'm going to be shaving this up soon, too.
What's yours, Joel?
My choice, gentlemen, I want to take you back to a time when we were all together on a hill...
Oh,
sunset.
Yeah.
My favorite cover art is episode 310, Tiermorrow, where we were doing.
Explain the story. Go on.
We were, it's our musical episode. We were actually all hanging out together. We had.
It was a Baconsale.
We had all of our
kids
bacon
there.
Bits got together.
Like all 76 of my kids. Yeah. And then, you know, Kent and Zach's as well. They got lost in the shuffle of my kids. But we were out hanging out together, having a good time. And then we're like, oh, we should get the cover art for this musical episode. What should we do? And there's a grassy hill nearby, so we decided to wander over there. And normally we just kind of pose, but for some reason we decided this time we were going to take this live shot of us three all spinning in a circle with our arms out together.
The hills are alive.
There's people around.
Oh, yeah,
there's tons of people around this park, and we're sitting there, three grown men.
Dad bods spinning in circles.
And we posted the raw pictures on patreon.com, and then Kent took those images of us, spliced them together, added like the epic logo at the bottom.
Who got dizziest first?
I got so dizzy from that.
Yeah.
I'm so old.
I just know that whenever we do something like that, Zack is going to break out into giggles.
Yeah.
And I think he was on the ground giggling.
We kept doing it. And then we had to keep taking pictures.
Yeah.
And your wife, who was taking the picture, was cracking up the entire time because we're being idiots. But I mean, that episode overall was a lot of fun. That's the one also where Zack was using a Snyder cut as a unit of measurement for how long the movie was.
This is 5/8 of a Snyder cut.
And then also that's one where we said we're going to start singing. We were filled with emotion, but it was mostly just me rage singing the whole time.
A lot of rage.
But it was a guy who was going to
rage dance at one point.
Yes, I did. It really is like, it was mostly because the experience, one of the reasons it's my favorite cover art, is because you could see that the goofy grins on our
absolute
faces.
Absolute joy.
Because we're having a
great
time.
And the sacrifice we made, the humiliation we suffered.
Yes, and then you turn it into this kind of musical looking thing. Honorable mention, by the way, to Hoppy Easter, where we got turned into Easter bunnies.
Mm-hmm.
And
again, so good.
And episode 332, the most wonderful treats of the year, when we just
gingerbread. Okay, we get it.
I like when Kent makes us stuff.
Me too. Mixes into stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll make it.
That's
mine. Stuff.
Best cover art tomorrow.
All right. I'm going to go with the great podcast caper. So this is one of those where normally we do photo shoots. Well, and I want to get to that. We do photo shoots together at times, but there are times where I'm like, guys, it's a Sunday afternoon and I want to publish the show in just a few hours. Send me a picture of you doing this. And I'll try to send like a demo
picture.
Send me
a picture of your nostrils.
Right. Exactly. Which we've done. And so I think I took a picture in a suit and I was like, I'm looking cool like this. And, you know, and so Joel, generally, you're the first one to send me a picture.
Yep.
And you sent this picture of you. You're smiling for a few, looking cool for a few
more. I tried to do
more.
A couple different takes.
But
my kids and wife don't even question anymore. I'm like,
no.
Can you come take a picture of me like Baconsale?
Yeah. But you did this one where you're kind of making plans on top of a table. And I'm like, that picture is amazing. Granted, looks like you were kind of conducting some sort of church meeting.
You guys look so suave. Like, and Zack has this like, you know, cool jacket on with his glasses and the earbud, and Kent's looking svelte.
Oh, well, you're the mastermind.
But then I'm sitting there like
I'm the hacker.
I'm literally wearing like white shirt and tie. It was the outfit I was wearing when I got home from church.
Yeah,
I'm
but
like,
it fit perfectly. And of course, I was the muscle. Because of course, I don't have muscles. What am I talking about? But somehow the picture worked perfectly. We had the safe behind us, the little Batmobiles.
The lasers. Yeah.
I mean, that show.
Yeah, the table of Batmobiles.
Yeah. And I mean, obviously, the show was kind of weird because we got betrayed by people that we drafted for our teams. Like, actual Cannibal Army Hammer betrayed my team.
Yep.
So that was rude. But anyways, I just love
that yet.
How cool. Alleged actual cannibal.
There you go.
I love how cool we all look there. Even Joel.
That was one of those pictures I may have spent way too much time looking at being like, that's so cool.
It is cool.
That's so cool.
There was the subtle thing, too. I had a couple pictures that you spliced together because my jacket was weird in one of them.
And
a little Photoshop.
I was going to say, you Photoshopped a little down my belly, so my tie was poking out near the bottom.
Okay.
It looked kind of goofy, so you kind of just blacked it out. But it looked cooler.
That was it was a proud moment. As I was scrolling through the Instagram feed, which if you want to see all these, just go to Instagram.
Or our photo album on Facebook.
Or the photo album on Facebook. I definitely stopped on this one. I was like, oh, that's a good episode.
We look cool.
That was really cool.
That was a good one.
I feel very cool.
How's your ego, Kent?
Really good. Can we talk about you now?
No.
All right. Next up, we are going to talk about Joel because we have best blurb.
This is a new category this year.
It is a new category.
Joel never gets credit for these, and these are great.
Well, the blurb is the writing that kind of explains the episode, and my goal in doing it is to entertain but also inform. I don't want it to be just like, you know, random word jokes that no one gets.
Well, more goes into it than that, more than just puns or references to the category that we're talking about. After we record every episode, Joel's kind of like, hey, what inside jokes do we have? And we throw out like 5 or 6 inside jokes. He notes those, and those also become part of the blurb.
They try to, yes.
Yeah. So I think it's fantastic.
I do enjoy when I can like work in song titles or like, you know, characters like in the sentence of it. Kind of like one of those old candy boards where you put the candy there. I enjoy when I can do that. But the one I picked was actually, it was short. But I feel like it portrayed the emotion that I was really going for. And it's a bacon bit.
Oh,
I chose.
We have the same one.
I have the same one as well. Will you sing it for us? Will you sing it?
So that's the one you guys liked. Out of all the ones I did. No.
It's amazing.
So this is the Zack Snyder cut. If you don't know, Kent was obsessed with it. Coming out.
And is.
And then like it came out and it has the song Hallelujah in it.
Who wants to sing this?
Well, I'll give the thing because I have it here. So. Now we heard there was a secret cut that Snyder made and it pleased Kent, but you don't really care about the background, do ya? It goes for hours, this Justice League. We watched it all with some fatigue, but will it make Kent Dunn cry? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You went the Leonard Cohen mix on that one.
Yeah, you did.
Good job.
It's the bass one. So wait, we all picked the same one?
Oh, yeah, totally.
There was something magical to that one. Like, they're all great. They all kind of jump out without having too many exclamation points, but that one was just perfect from start to finish.
It just felt right for like the emotion that was being portrayed in that, of like, this is the moment of Kent.
Yeah.
But
if I was going to shout one out, I do have a secondary choice from my wife, which is episode 289. You had me at rom-com. This is one where Joel goes through and he basically, much like those candy posters that you used to get, he just inserts as many titles of movies as he can,
tries to fit them in,
and none of them work, because so he has to put in parentheses.
Yes, that was where I used a lot of parentheses.
Lots of parentheses. So that one is also,
that's not very SEO friendly.
No, it's not.
You do very good work, Joel Hilton.
Thank you, Joel.
I can tell, because we all picked the same one.
Yeah. I actually went through on our background Baconsale Facebook page, searched the word blurb, and I read through all of them.
Yes, they're all there. Yes.
And so the Bacon Bit ones are fun too. So check those out. All right, now we have strangest episode format or topic.
Pod for Teacher.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's the weirdest show. So if you didn't hear that one, go back and listen. It's actually one of our most popular episodes of the season as well, which is strange because we kind of came up with it like 2 days before we recorded.
It was a quick turnaround on that one.
And we're like, let's give a shout out to teachers because teachers are great. And we're like, let's give us a school schedule. So the format for this one is, hey, what are the 8 main topics in school? Like English, history, math, science, arts, all that kind of stuff. All the basics. But then we went through and we created maybe a list of 5 or 6 teachers from pop culture.
Yep.
And those were the availability for arts, for
example. And then we played MASH.
Yes.
Then we played MASH. Zack would randomly select one of them.
I promise it was random.
Uh-huh.
Kent has a tendency to say people cheat when it doesn't go his way.
It never goes my way. Yeah, but it was great. I mean, for example, it's like Snape for the dark arts.
Edna Krabappel.
Yeah.
When Zack didn't know how to say it. Zack, you didn't know how to say her name. Do you know how to say it now?
Edna Krabappel.
But I just remember our headmistress was Trunchbull.
I know, that was the worst.
Yeah.
Like, I really was excited about my schedule.
It could have been Dumbledore, and
get Trunchbull.
Yeah. But yeah, it was a really weird, like, we've always wanted to do MASH. I hope that we can do that again.
I'd love to do that with another sort of category where we can do
that.
Yeah. We'll take suggestions. Well, mine, honestly, at its core, is not a weird thing. It's a very normal Baconsale show. I'd say probably the most common. It's a tiering show. But we took it in a very strange direction. That's episode 314, the Baconsalia Summer Olympics.
Okay.
It's a standard tiering show. We took the events that you see in the Summer Olympics and we just tiered them 1, 2, 3. But then we added that little wrinkle of deciding which one of us was going to represent Baconsalia, our made-up country, in that event.
Even though, Zack, you're not the best swimmer, are you?
I can't swim.
And you were
representing our country in a Speedo, which I should never be seen in.
Which was the official outfit of
Speedo was in everything.
Yeah, whether for archery.
Equestrian?
Yeah, exactly. Archery, that's dangerous.
Yeah.
Yeah, but this random wrinkle, because I agree, Pod for Teacher was interesting, the draft heist was interesting, but Baconsalia and us representing the country, and honestly, let's face facts, the Winter Olympics are next year, so
Baconsalia may be coming again.
Gonna be coming back. What do you have, Joel?
We already mentioned it, but I'm going to bring it up here. It's the Great Podcast Caper, episode 305. And this is one where, I mean, strangest episode topic, if you just think about this, the 7 Batmobiles are hidden in the Warner Brothers vaults beneath Mount Rushmore.
We just kept yes-anding this situation.
It was totally improvised.
Yeah.
We didn't have that completely planned out for us.
No.
Like, what are we stealing? Batmobiles and under Mount Rushmore. Sure, go with it. But then it was kind of similar to Pod for Teacher, but we were
more
picking.
Minesweeper, though.
Yes, because so we had a list of people that we could pick from, and if you picked one, I couldn't take them.
Like fantasy football.
Yes,
for example.
So it's like, you know, Danny Ocean from Ocean's 11, and then you get Brad Pitt from Ocean's 11. I can't think of anything.
Yeah,
you know?
Or like a Baby Driver's a driver.
Yes, because we had to pick
Transporter.
Yeah, it was like the lookout and the driver. Mm-hmm. Like, we had all these different roles.
Catherine Zeta Jones from Entrapment.
Zack added the additional twist of there are going to be moles. And if you didn't know who they were, if you
should get those checked out.
Yes. I've got plenty. But if we pick the wrong person, it would then damage our team. And then at the end, you know, whoever had the strongest team was able to pull off the caper.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the Batmobiles are great here in the Bacon Cave, personally.
Yeah, thank you for bringing those.
Yeah, no problem. Honorable mention, by the way, to episode 295, Movie Rebuffs.
Yeah,
where it was
yeah.
Movies that didn't happen. Like, that's a weird topic, I thought, of just like, we're talking about movies that never happened.
We kind of had to pitch them, even though they...
Yeah.
Are out there somewhere. Yeah.
And another honorable mention also to Brian Farron's episode where we talked about movies set in the future that were now in the past.
Mm-hmm.
It was one of those that was hard to wrap your brain around, but once you did, it was a fun ride.
How about the episode that took the most work? I'll start with this one, and I don't know. I honestly, it's three shows, but really two topics for me. I kind of already mentioned this, so I'm going to sort of cheat and say episode 330, Bonding with James, part two. But really, it's the James Bond shows.
Did we all pick this?
I picked that.
Yeah, so did I.
Episode 329, episode 330, and of the Bacon Bed Between.
Why did we all pick this?
Because it took us 2 years.
Yeah, 2 years.
This is 2 years of watching
and
movies.
And multiple rewatches. Like, yes. We went through and watched them, and then we rewatched them.
And we've said this a lot on the show. We said many times on that show, but this, when No Time to Die was going to come out, we're like, let's watch the whole franchise.
Yeah.
I've only seen like 10 of them. Let's go for it. And so from start to finish, that's 27 movies with like the spinoffs and
because
side
there's 25
projects.
Official ones and two non-unofficial
and
ones.
Maybe a documentary or two. And then when we forgot all about the Bond movies and No Time to Die was actually going to come out, we watched them again.
Yes. And it wasn't even just casual watching either the first time. I was actively sitting down and taking notes. I think I ended up having 64 pages of notes.
Mercy.
Which you can get at you can see at Patreon.
I only had 19 pages of notes.
But I just sit there and kind of type words as I was watching, like, oh, this is ridiculous. Why is that pigeon doing a double take? But and then also I wanted to give a shout out to any of the tournament shows. Like every time a tournament, people love the tournament shows. We enjoy doing
the first week is always really stressful.
Oh, it's so much work at that beginning there. And it's my fault. I know it's my fault. No one needed to know that, you know, one of the members of this band ran off and joined a cult. But I found it so interesting that I was like, I need to talk about this on the show.
You're writing his biography now.
For me, the harder one is the one that we usually do earlier in the year, which is the bands.
Yes.
Because, you know, when it's the one hit wonder, you're just listening to the song. Mm-hmm. When it's the bands, you want to make sure you have a feel. And mm-hmm. what are you going to listen to two or three songs and then determine what that band is?
Yeah.
So you kind of have to dig deeper.
Yeah.
And it's a lot of work.
Yeah, it is.
My goodness.
But we do enjoy this tournament shows. And the Bond show, I did enjoy. I had a great time doing it, but it was a lot of work.
We're not going to talk about Bond for a couple of years now.
No. Yes.
We've covered it.
It's okay. There's not going to make another movie for six in Baconsale. Who knows? You know.
Indeed.
Just saying. So we all picked that one?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's move on to the next, which is our favorite music moment.
I have a bone to pick with you two.
What? Mm. Why? What?
I used to be known as the musical guy here on Baconsale. Okay.
You still are. You write parody songs for people.
You guys
do.
I looked it up. You guys sang more than I did this season.
No.
There were more musical moments with you two than there were with me.
It's because I can't quit just doing it for my intros.
But, and that's not a problem because I actually enjoyed it. So I could be talking about Kent's chess parody and Tabletop of the World.
Oh, where he gave instructions. I don't even remember that.
You gave instructions for chess.
I forgot
about that one.
Yeah. You were talking about
was that pre-recorded?
Yes, it was a pre-recorded one. Okay. You did for the episode, and you're like,
I totally forgot.
You do
I
a
did
rap
that.
Breakdown in the middle, but it's all about how to play chess. I so could have dumb. Also done your Island in the Sun parody for the Chicken Sandwich Wars. Chicken.
Oh, wow.
Chicken. That was fun, too. I know we just talked about James Bond, but I'm also going to give the music moment to Boopfinger, because Boopfinger was that thing kicked off. And I was like, oh, okay, Goldfinger. This is a fun parody. He's going to try and sing it. And then you said Boopfinger, and I'm like, that is so perfect. That is a perfect parody.
Yeah.
Like just
the to the point
finger.
Now when we agree.
Dun, 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 dun. And then Zack followed up with the Skyfall parody on the next one where you listed all the later James Bond movies, which cracked me up.
Skyfall, the modern
days. Like whatever. You said, we were talking about Boopfinger at the end of the season. Here we are.
Yep.
So there's my favorite music moment is Boopfinger.
Love it.
We've talked about it, but I want to play it in its entirety.
It's Baconsale with our
oh, no.
Kent, Joel, and Zack. Yeah!
Just the planning that went behind this. We don't usually plan out
no.
as much.
We rehearsed it a few
it's
times
time
with each
to
other.
Play the music. It's time to light the lights. It's time to talk about
that's
the
just us three. No layering.
It's time to test our vocals.
We're all doing faces and swaying.
Are we so proud of ourselves?
Yeah. That's what this whole show is.
Why do you always come here? I guess we'll never know. We hope it isn't torture to listen to our show.
Here's where it kind of maybe falls apart.
It's time to get things started.
It's so sensational.
Oh, no.
Educational, confrontational,
building.
Motivational. This is what
hit that
we
high note, guys.
Baconsale.
That's so silly.
So silly,
fun.
But
it was fun.
The fact that that felt like where we united, and we only did two takes. I listened to both today. Both sound almost equally like that, except for one had like a scream at the end.
Yes.
That was kind of perfect as well. But guys, I really think that's where we've sounded our best.
As Muppets?
Not only with impressions. Yes, as Muppets. But we were so excited to do that show as well, because that's when we watched all the Muppet movies. Mm-hmm. Oh, man, that was a joy.
That was
an absolute joy.
I'm glad you got a clip of it, because, I mean, it, you could go back and listen to it, but it's fun to hear it and talk about it.
All right, Zach?
My choice for this one. I'm going to talk about it again probably a couple more times on this episode.
For the favorite musical moment.
This is my favorite musical moment because it does involve a song. Now, we sing a lot on the show. There's a lot of great moments. You guys all do great. I love you. This was a moment that happened in the course of a song that has changed my life forever.
What?
Jumping.
Oh, here we go.
Jump. So Jump starts playing.
If you want to tease my kisses.
I love that lyric.
I also feature
it. Ken starts acting like a dolphin.
Starts acting like a dolphin.
Why are you a dolphin?
So I went to SeaWorld and saw a dolphin show.
And I can't remove that memory from this song. And they were jumping, right? And they were doing the background like...
You should see Ken right now. Here, Ken, here's a fish. Good job.
I'm dying laughing here.
Dying.
This is from Twitter Winner.
Yeah. And it was so cool because I was seven
so
and
hear,
I was at SeaWorld.
In just a second.
And is there a better experience than being a 7-year-old at SeaWorld?
I'm like, wheezing.
Yes.
Yeah.
But we had to stop the show because Zach was laughing so hard.
Yeah, 2 hours later.
Jumanian's been ruined.
Yeah, so that's the thing. Yeah. Obviously you kept on laughing and we stopped because we're like, Zach, pull it together, man.
Come on, man.
I literally was hunched over drooling from laughter.
It was church humor, right? When you know you're not supposed to laugh, you were laughing like that.
And I'm not kidding you. Tonight, I was reviewing this list. I played this clip and started laughing again that hard. I still find it that funny. If I think about it, it is a straight up trigger for.
I don't understand why, but I love it.
But
when Ken became a were-dolphin during Van Halen's jump.
It's so dumb. See, there you are again. Are you okay? Like, what do you visualize? What do you visualize
you
when you hear
dolphin.
That? Like, me as a dolphin or me just kind of backing up like. Like, that's it, Zach. What is it about that noise?
He's triggered again.
Zach!
We're going to have to pause the show again.
And it's so funny because I'm like, I feel like making Zach laugh right now. And I could just say that.
I cry every time.
Oh, the tears are good.
It's a very emotional experience. So thank you for that.
You're welcome.
Twitter Ruler was a fun show.
So good. Still, well,
we don't have anything after the show. It's static.
It's true.
This is all
clean. I can't even use it.
Nope.
So once again, Zach. Once again,
okay. We killed him. We killed Zach.
Come back to us. The dolphin can't hurt you.
All right, next up, we have most entertaining research. Joel, go so I can recover. I don't know who's up next.
Oddly enough, the one I picked for this is actually kind of a spooky research one.
Okay.
I chose Haunts Around the World, episode 324, where mm-hmm. we have the beaker. And one of the reasons I picked this one is because this got me into the Halloween mood. Like, this was early October, and I was researching all these different spooky places, and I was... watching these videos of them, which I normally would do anyway. I love watching those haunted places types of videos, but I was able to find these specific places and learn a bunch of stuff about them.
Well, and how many did you know? Maybe a quarter of them before?
Yeah. And so I was looking at this place I'd never heard of before, watching videos of it, getting a visual representation of what was happening. And it, like I said, it really got me into the Halloween spirit. It was also just a fun episode to do. I mean, aside from the spoopy references.
Spoopy.
Stop with the spoopy. But then Kent hitting on all the ghosts was also pretty highly entertaining.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
But that was an episode where we had to rank whether we were willing to stay at these places or not. And it was just funny to me how, you know, Beaker was just like, yeah, I'd stay at all these. No big deal.
Right.
And Zach's like, nope, none of them.
Yeah.
Basically none except for the really nice hotels. But then I found myself a bunch of times being like, I'd totally stay there. My wife would never do it, but...
A full night by yourself?
Some of them, yes. No problem.
Okay.
Yes. But I had so much fun researching that. So thank you, Tim, for allowing me to do that, because that was one that I just went, man, that was fun.
All right, mine is Jingles All the Way.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Zach,
yeah.
I don't think you were there.
I was not on this episode.
And I called Terry Filler.
You did.
You were Zach.
Our filler. Yeah. He's like, Terry's Filler. And I'm like, I call her a guest, Zach.
Yeah. I don't know why I said that. That's so mean. But the research with this one was basically just jumping into YouTube and going down the rabbit hole.
Oh, so many commercials from my childhood.
Yeah, and it was kind of like watching these recorded commercials from a VHS somewhere, basically. And it was just kind of like a couple mentions were like Frosted Flakes, like, show them that you're a tiger.
Show them what you can do.
You, by the way, in that episode, Joel broke the Liberty theme, I believe it was.
Liberty, oh, Liberty, okay. Liberty.
See, that's what makes me mad, because we talked about Chili's, Toys R Us, Mentos. But the song that has stuck in my head since then is Liberty.
Really? So the one I picked for most annoying.
Yeah. Liberty, I blame you.
Liberty, Liberty.
And I hate you for it. But doing that kind of research was amazing, because it almost qualified for nostalgia for me. But honestly, just it was so much fun to hear these songs again.
It was.
And have them in my head an entire week.
Yeah. And then to hear Liberty, you guys pull up ones and I'm like, oh, that one. Like even that Tony the Tiger one, Kent. Mm-hmm. I didn't remember when you started out. And then all of a sudden I was like, oh, yeah.
Yeah, from like 1993.
Yeah, and then we both sang the rent-to-own number like multiple times.
My most entertaining research came from the tournament of the 70s rock bands.
Oh, yeah.
I had a really good time just jumping. I mentioned earlier, you have to listen to multiple songs per band. I had a really good time jumping in, and this is kind of my year of classic rock, both, you know, from the show, but I'm listening to it at the barbershop. It's kind of my go-to, and I'm not mad about that. And so I think it was really entertaining to go through, and I can hear all these bands, hear all these songs, and have them pop in like, oh, that's, I recognize that song. I really like that song.
We voted them out first round.
What cracked me up too is also just, I find out something and I go to my dad and be like, Dad, did you know this person was also in this band? He's like, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We all knew that. And I'm like, oh
yeah,
I just learned it.
Yeah.
And news. Yeah. That was also where I got really mad at you guys.
For what?
For voting out Blue Oyster Cult earlier than you should have.
You know, when did we? Like second round? Cowbell made it the second round, I think.
Did it though? Because I'd have to go back and listen.
We typically on these shows have a category that was cut this year, which is a tournament match you'd want to redo. Mm-hmm. Joel, I just want to redo every bracket we've done this year. Sorry about that.
You know, you're the decider on these brackets.
I do a bad job.
I tried so hard on our brackets.
Yeah, yeah. All right, how about episode that deserves a sequel?
So, Joel, you just talked about this. Haunts around the world.
Oh, yeah.
And he brought his supernatural knowledge to the show. And he led us in these discussions where, you know, we're a little more scared than he is, obviously.
Yeah.
Because for me, there are many places I wouldn't even want to visit, because I feel like my soul would be destroyed. But I love that show, and I laugh
at your soul being destroyed.
Precisely. I think we only did like a dozen locations,
it was
right?
It was a limited number. Yeah, but we had four of us talking about it, so we had to limit it.
So why I say it could have a sequel is there are so many more haunted locations we didn't talk about.
Yep, famous ones.
And I would love to talk about how much I don't want to go there.
I'd love to watch more videos on them.
Yeah.
So for mine, well, I guess I'll say my honorable mention from my wife says she would be fine with another Disney songs bracket. You know, maybe not the full 64, but there's a lot more to go to there. My mom wouldn't mind another board game episode of some kind, sequel to Tabletop of the World. Mm-hmm. But mine is episode 324, Haunts Around the World.
Hey!
It's a great choice. There's so much more we could do. And I wouldn't go to any of those places. And I'm not super into this topic, but it was one of those shows, and I get this every so often, where I just get to sit back and watch and listen to Baconsale live. And as a listener, it was really enjoyable to hear you talk about it and, you know, see some of these places and hear about some of these places. And
I think it hit the right tone of Baconsale, which is a little bit spooky, but funny.
And then very informational. You know,
you're learning about these places.
Yeah.
And it almost takes some of the scary out and makes it just more interesting. But then every once in a while, you're reminded of like, ooh, spoopy.
They'll say something. Throw that not spoopy. Spoopy.
What does spoopy mean again?
It's like cute. It's cute. Like it's like a ghost. A dog in a ghost costume.
It's like ghost stickers.
Like picture a little ghost costume with a little doggy nose sticking out.
Oh,
like
spoopy.
A little dog. Yeah, hey, spoopy.
Cool.
I chose kind of a gimme because it's going to get a sequel because we built in a sequel. It's episode 303, Bet You Can't Tear Just One.
Yes.
And I wanted to give some love to this one because, first of all, I definitely think we should do a chip tearing show. Once again, I want to apologize for putting a cracker on there.
Goldfish crackers. But
you
don't have to apologize.
I do because I put it on there because I peer pressure, honestly. I saw it in some
Because you want to have a cracker show.
I think we should. And I did vow that we will have goldfish on the cracker show.
Okay.
But this is also, I want to give some love because this is one where Bag of Bags came from.
On the cracker show just to do it?
Just to mess with them?
The Bag of Bags.
This is where Bag of Bags came from. When poor Zach was trying to just make a comment about the bag you buy where it has multiple little mini bags inside. He's like, you know, it's just like that, the bag of bags. And we're getting there just like, oh, the bag of bags.
Surely you adjust the bag of bags.
Which has become vernacular, common vernacular here in the Bacon Cave where we'll talk about the bag of bags.
I've like been to several barbecues since then where there's a bag of bags.
Also, very good episode art.
Yes.
This one caught my eye.
Oh, yeah, that was fun.
It's an old school Doritos.
The Doritos logo with all the chips mixed in it.
It says bag of bags.
I'm surprised we didn't go back to that well for the chips this past season.
We talked about it. And then I think Zack wanted to push it to next season.
Season okay. 8.
So we're going to get it next season. This is also where I had you guys stand up and do the Frito twist.
The
instructions that are
anytime
impossible
you try to
follow.
To make me dance on the show, and I'm like, Joel, it's a podcast.
And
please
that
don't
random
do this.
I Love Onions song was in that too.
Oh yeah,
like two clips in there. Yeah. But and I love chip tearing. Food tearing shows are fun to me because it is very relatable. Like anyone can usually jump in and be like
hey,
yeah.
I think people have eaten.
I think people have eaten chips.
Yeah.
Although we talked about some weird ones like the ketchup flavored ones, but
yeah.
So and I think that I hope you guys will enjoy our part two of Bet You Can't Tear Just One.
All right, now let's look at just some favorite moments. What's your top three favorite moments? Maybe no particular order.
And these could be on air or off air.
Well, Zack, you tell us.
I will start. Well, as it's going to be no surprise that I find a great humor in episode 297, Twinner Winner, the songs edition.
Yep.
I could call out really my three right here, but I will say this is one of them. Just the episode in general. Kent's Van Halen Dolphins.
Yep.
Sarah McLachlan.
Yep.
Carl.
And the triple play tri-tip Three's Company tri-corner hat of doom. Hat trick.
What was that on again?
That was when we had the Twinner Winner, but it was three songs.
Oh,
that
yeah.
Against,
it kept getting bigger and bigger each time.
Couldn't say triplets.
Could, yeah.
triple twins or something like that.
My
it went insane. So just so many funny moments on that show. But then also poor pronunciations back to back in both episodes 317, Pod for Teacher, and 318, where we talked about Grimm.
Yes.
And, the Wessons.
Edna Kerberber. And then Everything You Made Me Say in German.
Yep. Yeah, thank you for that.
So we'll say that's my moment number two. You guys are jerks. And then very recent show where I still laugh very hard, episode 331, Choose Your Own Hunger Games, where Kent is just yelling, Matt,
are you giving Joel a back massage as we're playing the game?
The thing is,
Matt,
Kent, the thing is, I can tell you're fake angry right now. Your voice isn't doing the same thing it was then.
No, I was actually angry.
Matt! Like, it was like
no
growl.
I mean, let's go back to that real quick. Behind the scenes, when we play those games, for example, when Jake would lead those games, it was very precise, and it was kind of like he was playing Dungeons and Dragons with us, and if we were going to die, if we chose a death, he would try to delay that death from happening so we could play the whole game. Matt's was out for blood. He wanted me dead. And honestly, it didn't matter because I feel like even me dying halfway through the episode, me and my love, halfway through the episode.
Yeah, because you died, then you killed Lindsay Sterling as well.
She died. I didn't kill her.
No, you climbed a tree.
Zack told me to.
And you said, why would I do that? I'm going to do it.
I'd only ever won one fight in my life.
Somehow it worked because then I was able to sit back and be really upset and give color commentary.
Most angry ghost we've ever had on Bacon Sale.
Precisely.
What about you, Joel?
I have so many. I'm trying to figure out which ones to pick. Yeah. I mean, I could have talked about the multiple spider attacks in the Bacon Cave.
I forgot about that. Break it down?
I was going to say, episode 309, the one where we talk TV. If you listen to the uncut version, you hear the whole thing. But this is the one where Kent says, Kent and Braden both are like, there's a spider over there. And I'm like, I'll get it. And I try to squish it, and it runs away. And the whole rest of the episode, they're like, is it there? Is it there? And then episode 315 is the one where Kent gets up and stands out. This is Ask Bacon Cell again. Freaks out. He's like, there's a spider on me. And then he gets up and he's like, you know, crying. I think he wet himself. And then I'm trying to kill it again and we can't find it.
No.
And all of a sudden, Kent just goes, it's on the table.
Here's what happened. Because I claim
this isn't even my pick, by the way.
I claim to be a spider hunter. Like,
this is
I'm
my
not
wife's pick.
I'm not afraid of spiders. Like, I'm tough. But there was this big wolf spider. I swear it was like red too. It was menacing. And
it
so
had a tattoo, smoking a cigarette.
It had a little tear tattoo by the side of its eye. Anyways, brass knuckles as well.
Yep. On each of its legs.
And I usually get tissues and I kind of like do this little half smash and then I put it in the toilet. But I got it with the toilet paper and Joel, you were very willing to kill it. But I was like, look, I got this. And then all of a sudden it fell out of the tissue or something and I started screaming and I flipped my. Oh, no. It crawled out of the toilet paper.
Yeah.
Got on my hand and I went, do you want me to do the sound?
Sure.
Ah! That was
literally that sound. And I flip my hand, the spider was gone. Then we start recording, and it's on the day. Zack, it's right in front of you!
Yeah.
I was terrified.
You just peeked twice.
And every time we record now, I kind of look around, make sure one's not crawling on me.
I was going to say, it was infestation this year.
Yeah.
So that wasn't even my pick.
Ken versus that's my spider. Motivation.
It's so good. I was going to say, I could talk about the multiple spider attacks. I could also talk about my favorite answer in all of Baconsale 300 episode. When Zack says, this burger chain is called Hungry Jack's in Australia. And Kent goes, oh, I went there in my black hole period. It's Australia.
I forgot about that. This is mean. I don't like these memories.
I could also
Joel.
Talk about our no power Bacon bit where we had no power at the Bacon Cave and had to record on a laptop.
Oh, yeah.
That was the same night we did the Wheel of Cheese. That was fun, too.
Oh, yeah.
But my top three. Here we are. I'm finally here. Winning the Hunger Games with my wife.
Yeah.
On episode 331, mm-hmm. Choose Your Own Hunger Games. And even though Kent said cheated, he said Zack cheated on Pod for Teacher,
you
too.
Didn't cheat. He cheated for you.
I chose different paths. I went back and listened. It's all very legitimate.
You took a nap
I trust Max.
On a loaf of bread.
I did, and I lived.
Arrows were flying.
I wasn't running full speed for a trident or getting in my first fight ever.
He survived the first fight, by the
but
way.
I was going to say, there's some gratification in, even though it was imaginary, my wife and I both making it to the end.
It's pretty special.
To get her dead.
It's for the kids.
Number two would be Zack casually announcing on one of her Pacon bits that he was engaged.
Oh, yeah. That was pretty fun.
Kent comes home, and he's like, Germany, 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 Germany. Germany.
Like,
by the way, I engaged my girlfriend. And we're like, what?
And then we saved it.
Yeah. And it was like a meaningless, you know, string of, oh, yeah, I started watching TV. I started playing Pokemon Go. I'm engaged.
Yes. He just kind of downplays it.
It took me 7 seconds.
And we all kind of went, wait, because we had no idea.
What did you say?
That was on She Breached My Culinary Bubble, by the way, if you go back and look for the Pacon bit.
Yeah.
Also, we had Zack's bachelor party and also his wedding. I mean, those were all kind of grouped together in this.
Yeah, it was a big
fun
year for me.
Seeing the growth of Zack in that regard was very gratifying.
I'm a big boy now.
Which seems, it sounds terrible to be like, that's my number two of Zack getting married and finding happiness. Number one.
Okay, let's hear it.
Is all three of our cars arriving together at the exact same time. So we're going to have this planning meeting in a restaurant called Times and Seasons in Bountiful. And we said, okay, we'll be there at this time. And, you know, that's normal. You just kind of arrive. We
within 5 minutes of
each
other.
If one got there ahead, we get, you know, get the table and get it all started.
Right.
No big deal. But we start, I'm just driving there. And as I drive in, I noticed that you guys, one of you was about to turn in and then one of you was behind me or something. There was two different entrances. And then we all kind of arrived at the, without planning it, without messaging each other, mm-hmm. we all arrived at the exact same time and we all pulled into spots right next to each other. It was
beautiful.
Like a scene from a Fast and the Furious movie with two really good cars in my car.
Yeah.
And then I got out and we were just like laughing about it. Zack took a picture and that is now our background, like our cover photo on our Facebook.
It's a great moment.
On our background Bacon Cell like private page where we talk about shows. So random. Zack's happiness is secondary to our car parking.
It was, I know. I
Zack's agree with that choice. Happiness.
It was really good.
All right. My number three choice is making Zack laugh. Like, honestly, anytime.
As a dolphin?
That would be like the prime way to get him to laugh. But anytime he giggles and interrupts the show.
It's the wheezy giggle.
It's the wheezy giggle. Yeah. That's not a band name. I don't know. But that, I truly enjoy that. And it came up again in Ask Baconsale again.
Yeah.
And you laughed almost as hard.
Yeah.
Like, it's ridiculous. So anytime I can get Zack to just ruin the flow of the show by laughing,
yeah,
it makes me so happy. Also, the photo shoots. That's another one of my moments is just the photo shoots that I make you guys do. For example, Joel, you talked about Tiramaro.
Yes.
Where we were spinning. Even though we could have just held still and got a clear photo, but we didn't. Also, we did the Haunting of Baconsale House where...
The sleeping bags?
Okay. No, not yet. Oh. But we were doing a poltergeist one where we were touching the TV.
Oh, yeah.
And my mom took the picture.
We all, and your mom is not used to this.
No, not
She's like,
at all.
What are you doing? And like, we're just going to kneel over here and touch the wall. Take a picture of our backs.
At one point, she's like, pull your shirt down. Yeah, I can see your crack. And I was like, oh, cool, mom. Thanks. Thanks very much. And just like that, Hunts Around the World where I'm like, guys, send me a sleeping bag picture immediately.
Yep.
Yeah. It was amazing. Live in concert was great. We went out just outside the Bacon Cave and we were doing like, and it's 2 a.m.
Yeah.
Rock on poses, great podcast caper. I love doing photo shoots with you guys and asking for pictures. Thank you for the database that I currently have.
You have a lot of pictures of us.
Number one, and these are all kind of like close together, but it's the Bacon bit where I'm really excited to go to Germany. I'm going to travel for the first time in a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. It's like, yeah, finally.
You're going to see a pretty girl that you were very interested in.
Right. And I was like, I'm going to see some castles. I'm going to Europe for the first time. This is amazing. And then Joel all of a sudden just kind of throws out there, hey, Kent, isn't there like a museum, like a Never Ending Story museum in Germany? And I was like,
yeah, yeah, I remember you talking about that. We Google immediately and realize the Neverending Story Museum is in Munich, Germany.
The exact same city you're going to.
The exact same city. And I freaking lost it.
You were so happy.
Oh, to write Falcor.
Like, seeing a girl, like, no longer mattered, which is true in retrospect as well.
Yeah.
But seeing Falcor. And then when I'm on the vacation for 10 days, I just get... And you guys, we didn't text a lot at that time, but Joel texted me, has it happened? Have you gone?
That's all I wanted to know.
And I didn't go to like my second to last day. And then finally, and I took, by the way, maybe 30 pictures of my whole trip.
A lot of pictures.
40 pictures of me on Falcor, pushing kids out of the way and everything like that.
Which I'm perfectly okay with.
Yeah. But that, realizing that I was about to see Falcor, and that was like, I was entirely gleeful.
Yeah. That was a great moment on a picking bit.
Because if you never said that, I would have never known it was there.
I don't even remember how I knew it was there.
Yeah, it was.
Divine intervention, I guess.
Yeah, honestly, magic.
Yeah. But yeah, and then you bought an R and you have like the little symbol.
Yeah, absolutely.
Neverending Story that you've worn since that day. It's under your shirt.
There's
right
a mark now.
Now.
Yes, precisely.
All right. What was your surprise hit episode, gentlemen? Start with you, Joel.
I actually put this one as episode 313, Canadian Bacon Sale. This was so random. And it was also the night we double recorded that night, if I remember right. That was right after the second half of the Disney Songs Tournament. We jumped right into Canadian Bacon Sale.
We did Ask Bacon Sale the second.
That was a different night. That was the other time.
Oh, yeah. Geez. Summer was crazy.
Yeah, we had a couple double up episodes there. And you can always kind of tell because we don't really read quotes on those. It's like, this is what people probably
know. And get a little slap happy as well.
Yeah, sometimes. Oh, yeah. It gets a little goofy. But this was like one of those random ones we joked around about doing for years, about doing just a Canada show. And then we did it, and people seemed to actually, it resonated with people. People were making, like talking about, I didn't know they were Canadian or their favorite Canadian thing. There was a whole discussion about poutine, which... Where I'm now going to try very soon.
Yeah.
Because of some gifts we got. Also, this is when I called out Drake. He's still not accepted my challenge.
Drake.
He's not accepted my challenge yet, so I'm calling that a win for me.
He tried to call you on your cell phone.
I know when that hotline bling came. But no, I really enjoyed doing the episode, and I think people enjoyed it well. And it was kind of ones where, wow, that actually went pretty well for a random episode of Bacon Cell. So Canadian Bacon Cell.
Great pick.
Go back and listen to it.
Yeah. I went with horror video games.
Yeah.
This is our first. We always kind of have unofficial.
First official.
Because there's October a Stephen episode. King episode preceding the October shows. But our first October show was the horror video games. And when we plan these shows, we're like, okay, do we have like easy shows to take care of? Like we can make a list or we can rank or whatever. And we're like, video games? Our audience is like kind of split on video games.
Mm-hmm.
It's not as accessible as movies or music or food. Let's just throw it out there if people enjoy it. And it's our highest rated or highest ranked show from the Halloween season, which is surprising.
Yeah.
But it was also really fun because we got to talk about the history of it all.
Like remembering some of those games, I was like, oh, that's right.
Yeah. And I threw in the music behind all the games. But it was fun and people actually enjoyed it, which is surprising.
Yeah.
I have a shout out from my mom and wife who liked the episode 291 Dresden Files.
Mm-hmm.
Ended up being super fun, you know,
which I had no previous
talking
knowledge
a book
of.
That almost nobody has heard of. And it actually ended up being a really
good
episode.
I was going to say, listen to that. You guys both commented that you were going to read more. Have you ended up reading more books?
I got like an hour into the YouTube and I still have it saved.
Okay.
Been a little busy.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. But.
I've already read a few.
So my pick is already mentioned on the show. It's 302. See You in the Funny Papers. I was like, this is not going to work. First of all, again, I don't have the connection to it. I'm like, it's comics. Yes, I know that we talk about movies and that's a visual medium, but it's comics. Who's going to relate to this or who's going to like this? And it ended up being a smash and everybody was again feeling all nostalgic and commenting on all these things. And I've had, you know, people tell me that they loved the episode.
Yeah.
And I was just kind of shocked.
I'm glad we did that one. I mean, comics aren't really around anymore, but the longer we would have waited, I think.
Yeah, less relevant.
Yeah.
All right. Now we have favorite listener interaction.
So this is a new one. Favorite listener interaction. Like we said, we've had drunk trains, several of them.
Sure. Those are a lot of fun.
Just a lot of people giving us their list or their tiers of things that we talk about, which is great. Making fun of us, which is always perfect.
We love it.
But there was one time, it was right after, and I know I've kind of, this is less about the show, more about the listener, but after we did Jingles All the Way, and also kind of goes off of board games as well, we have a listener named Stephen Hamilton.
Mm-hmm.
And on Twitter, he reached out, commented on our post, and he said, you missed a big one on the show. And so phonetically, he wrote out the words for this game called Crossfire. Yes. And it's a very popular commercial from the 90s.
Really kind of like extreme commercial where these kids are shooting the marble across from each other, hitting the little toys in the middle that are spinning around. It's like there's flames and
you
rock.
And I both knew that we missed out by not including that one, but it didn't quite fit anywhere for us.
Yeah.
We asked him to perform it, and he said, "I was made for this moment. Practice it in the shower this morning and everything." And then I responded, "We're going to need a fully clothed rendition of the song in public, please."
Yes.
And then he sent us this on Twitter.
And I actually I picked the same one.
Wonderful.
And this is the clip that you got to see the video because his emotion is really in his face. But you can hear it in his voice, this dramatic reenactment of Crossfire.
Crossfire, you get caught up in the crossfire. Crossfire, you get caught up in the crossfire. Crossfire, crossfire, crossfire.
It's so good.
Yep. Thank you, Steven.
Yes. I had that same one because I think, it's like I said, I've
watched it 37 times.
I've watched it many times too. The Drunk Train by Drew Cutler, I always enjoy those. He did the one for the Christmas Treats, mm-hmm. which cracked me up. It was like a 7-minute long Drunk Train where he takes our voice and slows it down and makes it sound like we're drunk. It's pretty entertaining. And I did put Spencer Larson, that picture of you as Ralphie Kent.
Really? That got you that much?
So perfect. Because it was Christmas themed. It was how I pictured you writing those punts and being very satisfied with yourself.
It's true.
That's why I put the picture of his brother cracking up because I was like, that's what I was doing. So yeah. Thank you, Stephen Hamilton, for making my day on that. That really cracked me up.
I did love that moment. And that is a great one. And one I considered. However, I kind of cheated and did episode 315 as my pick, which is Ask Baconsale again, just because I wanted to say thank you to the listener for submitting questions for an Ask Baconsale.
We always get a little nervous about that because we're like, are we going to get enough questions?
Ten
are we
going to have 10 questions, maybe?
And then we're like, you know, okay, maybe we can, you know, pull our wives or our parents. Yeah. And
you guys were stressing.
We can get people to do questions. And you guys came through and we had, once again, too many to do. And we could only get through, you know, the ones we could.
Yeah. So thank you. I'm sure it'll come up again at some point. And
these were all, this category is mostly for social media interaction, but I really enjoyed, like, you know, when the guests would come on our 300th episode, meeting those guys and being able to hang out with them for a bit and have individually rapped
treats. Brandon Keurig's voice.
He's got a great voice.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah. But it was fun to get to know you guys and then just meeting people. You know, just seeing people,
which is we are sad that once again this year we haven't been able to meet anyone live.
Yeah, it's still a little weird.
We're hoping next year is okay.
Yeah, hoping for that.
Yes, we are. All right, what is the show that we wish happened? I will start this one, and I'll confess something. I anticipated that this show would happen this season. There is a patron that I know in the I Am the Listener tier, who I had an insider tip that they might have wanted to do a show on a TV show. And so in preparation, I started watching Gilmore Girls.
Oh,
yeah.
And I just, the fact that it was for nothing and we didn't do a Gilmore Girls show kind of makes me just wish we had done it. There are just things that I know now that I don't get to talk about. There are things that I have in my brain. There are opinions on this show that I've never seen before. Lorelai should have married Max. This is ridiculous.
Stop.
Come on.
Stop.
Now, okay. I think it's perfectly acceptable. This is actually my answer too. I wanted to do a
Gilmore Girls show.
I like the show and I think it should be talked about more. And I would love to have that insider guest come here and then we could talk about it.
So, I think we have a better plan for the show that she may be on.
I still think we should do a Gilmore Girls episode.
Probably we'll just still do the Gilmore Girls show.
I don't want to.
It has to be for something.
Now, Joel, I know you've been a fan of Gilmore Girls for a while.
Yes.
Didn't you say that you, of Rory's boyfriends, you really like Dean the most? You said that, right?
I never said that, Ken. I never said that. Don't put words in my mouth.
You said it.
Did not.
See, there's clearly passion here for the Gilmore Girls.
I've seen one season. Okay.
Oh, well, I think we should do a show.
Mm-hmm. Show that I really want to do. This is more of a summer show, and this is, I think we focus less and less on movies every single year we do Baconsale.
Well, something happened that canceled movies.
Oh, that's true. That but I want to do a show, kind of a creature feature, specifically When Animals Attack show. Yeah, kind of like Jaws, The Shallows, Crawl.
Oh, I thought you meant like the documentary series When Animals Attack.
I would love that as well.
Why are we doing that?
The research would be pretty fun for that.
No.
But I want to talk about like giant spiders or just creepy crawlies
like
in movies. No.
In
narrative movies.
Okay,
so
okay.
I think it'd be really fun to kind of, I don't know if we tier them, categorize them or whatnot, but just to talk
battle
about these.
Battle bracket.
Honestly, that'd be
Bruce
kind of cool,
the Shark,
right?
Versus.
Oh, Bruce never works.
One of the other names.
None of them really against have, the Piranha. Names.
Yeah, but Piranhas.
Yeah. Anyways, I really would like to do that show, maybe even in the future. I think it'd be pretty fun.
Okay, that's a good choice. We should do that one.
Green light?
Green light. All right, now what is your biggest accomplishment?
Related to Baconsale.
Wait, ours, like personally, our biggest
accomplishment? No, related to Baconsale during this past season.
I had a lot of things happen this year.
You did. But. Once again, I have an honorable mention I just want to bring up real quick. Just as a collective, and mostly this is for Kent and for Zach, learning how to do remote recording.
Honestly.
Some of you listener don't know, if you're not a patron, we talked about it a little bit on there, but there were two episodes and a bacon bit where Zach was not physically in the bacon cave with us. He'd gotten the test positive back.
Yes.
And so we were being safe. He stayed away. And we'd never done this in all the history of Baconsale before, but we had him be remote. And if you don't know, that's great, because it worked.
Well, and you thought 2020 was bad. Like, we didn't even prep in that year for remote recording. We talked about it, and we kept our distance. We wiped down our microphones every single week and all of our equipment. Mm-hmm. But when Zach actually got it, I scrambled. Like, I don't know if you remember, I got scared.
Yeah.
And not of, like, getting COVID, but I'm like, what about the show?
Well,
the audio quality is going to be horrible. Zach, let's test a couple hours before the show.
Yeah. And we talked about on a pick about how we actually physically did it. But even just, we were like, should we push back the show? But it was the Subway show.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the Subway show and the one where we talked TV. And that Zach wasn't in the bacon cave when the spider attacked you. But and the bacon bit, I think, was Fast and the Furious. But Fast and Furious 9, I should clarify, right. F9. But that was one of those things where I went, man, this is a milestone for us.
And the audio quality is great.
And it sounded like he was in the room. And so props to you two for figuring out how to do that. And good job. That's what I'm saying for that. But that wasn't even my pick.
Okay.
Oh.
Because that was for you guys.
Thank you.
Actually, this is for all of us, too. I want to say episode 308. We ate everything at Subway.
Mm-hmm.
That was a show where Subway is one of the biggest fast food chains out there. And we were having such a hard time figuring out how we can do it when everything there is customizable. But we figured out how to do it. We ate everything on the menu.
We spent the most money we ever have.
It was tons of money. We figured that out. But then also, we made a difference. Because after that, 2 weeks after that show aired, Subway changed their entire menu.
They really did.
They listened to Baconsale, so they're like, oh, we don't sound good on that. And then they revamped their whole menu.
I considered this as an option for an episode that deserves a sequel. Because we at least should probably do a bacon bit. But I don't think any of us can stomach any Subway anymore.
I have not gone back.
Neither
have I.
I have not tried.
That's so weird.
Their new menu.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've gone to Burger King since.
I've gone to McDonald's, Burger King, Taco Bell, Wendy's. I've gone to them all.
Yeah.
I've not been back to Subway since the challenge ended. Maybe I just need time.
The biggest accomplishment, not my accomplishment, but the biggest accomplishment is Zach getting married.
Oh, thank you.
It was truly.
Or marrying Zach. Officiating the wedding of Zach.
Marrying Zach and honey.
Yes.
Yes.
Officially. Yeah. Okay. But no, Zach, you going through that milestone was amazing. Granted, you hit us with it in July. And then all of a sudden you're like, oh, and by the way, it's like in 2 months or so. It's going to be in December, but now it's in October.
Yeah.
And it all worked out perfectly.
Yeah,
it was such a happy moment. We were all there. We got to enjoy you guys dancing, good food, and just seeing one of our own, like, find that kind of happiness.
Yeah.
It was a pretty special moment.
Yeah.
Wow. I didn't think you were going to pick that, Kent.
What did you think I was going to pick?
I thought you were going to pick when you actually won the Oscar ballot for the first time in Baconsale.
Oh, my gosh. I totally forgot. Yeah. Sorry, Zach.
Yeah.
Winning the Oscar ballot that I totally forgot about.
Yeah.
I think I got street tacos or something like that. Street tacos are better than you getting married.
Yeah.
So thanks, though.
Shout out to the Baconsale listener who got to meet you guys at the wedding. That was pretty good.
Yeah.
My mom was very happy to meet you guys.
So, oh, we were nice to meet her, too.
Yeah. Wow. Plus my aunt. I mean, everybody was very happy.
They were so nice. Everyone was so great. That really was a great night.
Yeah. So biggest accomplishment, obviously related to Baconsale. But I mean, personally, I got married. I became a licensed barber. I've had a big year.
And a father.
Yes. But a stepfather. That was, it's all great. But it all pales in comparison.
Me winning the Oscar ballot. I know.
To eating Subway.
You stop that right now.
Finger.
Even though you had to eat four versions of their tuna, quote unquote.
Tuna. No, just going through this again, it was a daunting task, and I got really tired of it really quickly. To go through all this stuff, we had been
dealing
with
their
for a
app.
Long time. Dealing with the app crashing and getting
offering
the wrong
you 50% off a second foot long every time you open the app.
Over and over and over again. And it's so frustrating. And then
anger
to have it all culminate in, by the way, Zach, you tested positive and you can't even do this show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I'm like, what? And then figuring out how to do it remote, it was just, it was an appropriate, complicated finish to a complicated process. And weirdly enough, our
most difficult we ate everything
right
was
now.
The only one that I've participated in.
Well, and also it was the only one where people did not seem to want what we were talking about.
No.
Normally we get to the end of those, and that thing is a huge accomplishment, and people are kind of like, I'm good.
Like, good job.
I don't want to eat that.
No, people had...
You guys kind of smell like Wendy's for vinegar weeks. Now.
They went out and got chicken sandwiches after the chicken...
They yeah, got Christmas treats after our last episode.
Zack, I'm not going to blame you.
No.
I'll blame Subway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. But we don't even know what we're going to do next year, so...
I have an idea. I think we're set.
Okay. Yeah.
We're working on it.
Now we are to our final category. It is your favorite three episodes.
This is difficult. It always is. Although, I feel like there were clear... winners in the past, like one that we were all gonna say.
Yeah,
this time I'm not as sure.
No,
like I liked one a lot, but I'm like, I don't know if the other guys like them as much.
Sure.
Well, Kent, what's yours?
My first one's been mentioned a few times. It's Twinner Winner. Yeah. I'm assuming you guys might have this as well, unless you try to not have crossover with your answers.
I picked Twinner Winner as one of mine as well.
Twinner Winner. I mean, if you're gonna go through it, it's my number one of the year. It's my very favorite episode.
Wow.
Yes. It's the only show I've listened to multiple times just to listen
How many
to
time, times has your mom listened to it?
I don't think there's a number high enough. No.
So there are so many moments in this one, as you've mentioned, McLaughlin. Also, In the Arms of an Angel was Joel's relationship song.
Yeah, it was back in high school. No, college.
Oh, college. Okay. Yeah. Your Shaggy voice.
Yeah.
Can you do a Shaggy voice real quick?
Oh, yes, I can. We're going to do it again.
Oh, I thought you were talking about his Shaggy and Scooby voice.
Yeah.
Wow, there's that Scoob.
Too. When we talked about girls and it became Carl's.
Yes.
Carl's.
How did that happen?
I have no idea. It just happened.
Yeah.
And then also the dolphin noises and all that kind of stuff. Ocean Spray is Cranberries.
The conspiracy.
Yes.
Because this was the one where we were taking two songs with the same title and kind of mini bracket. Mini head-to-heads. And it was just kind of fun to see all these different songs that had the same title but very different feels. And we are, listener, we are building a new playlist so we can do it again of a Twinner Winner with the same titles. We're also working on a cover version where it's like the original and the cover.
Hype is real.
So these are fun playlists, too.
So like, you guys all chose this?
I did, yeah.
Okay.
I love, this is the Spotify playlist, Baconsale Spotify playlist I probably listen to the most because I love the songs on here.
Okay, so I'm just going to start this off again then.
Yeah.
And we've mentioned this as well, but I have not brought it up. The Baconsalia Summer Olympics.
Dang it!
That is also
as well.
I chose that as well.
It's my second highest.
Oh my god!
Okay. You know, so this is one. Kay, I always get, and I don't know if the listener knows this, but whenever I have to sing a song or something like that, I get nervous. I look at Joel and I go, Joel, I'm nervous again. He goes, Hey, it's just us. You've got this. Take a couple deep breaths. And so all of a sudden, it's like. Do, 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 do.
Yep.
And then all of a sudden, and then I was about to start my note or whatever, and then all of a sudden you just heard this. Oh.
You open your mouth towards the mic, and we just heard a stomach gurgle. It just went, "Arr."
So these guys, I was embarrassed because I was already nervous. You guys did not stop laughing.
We mocked you so much.
Yeah, and you can bring it up throughout the show.
In the outro.
Yeah, I put in the outro.
In the outro, we're just like, I was like, Kent, that is the best intro you've ever done. That was on topic. That was relevant.
Because it sounded like Stitch basically dying.
We started doing E.T.
And it was Taco Bell happening, basically, on that one.
Yeah.
But basically, I mean, drowning horses in water polo. Yep. Joel, you were the rhythmic gymnast.
Yes, yes.
And, I mean, in a Speedo as well. I don't even know how that happened. At one point in the outro, I didn't get the context, but it's... I said, you like goats? And then you guys said, oats. I don't even know where that came from.
I don't remember either. It was in the outro. And I was like,
maybe equestrian?
Probably.
Yeah. But that episode just gets me.
Well, and it was such a ridiculous topic. And it should have been very dry.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I remember we were talking about doing it. We're like,
I don't even know what the sport is.
So many sports.
Yeah.
There are so many. Like, there's like, you know, and we couldn't, we finally found in Wikipedia, we found a grouping of it. We're like, okay, we can do these 33.
Yeah.
And we're like, 33? We're going to tier 33. And it wasn't tier 1, tier 2, tier 3. It was gold, silver, and bronze.
Yeah.
And we're like, okay. And then we just came up with the idea of choosing a champion.
An equal amount of sports for each of us.
Where we each had to do an equal number. And then it morphed into this... country of Baconsalia, where we all wear Speedos.
I think you flexed half of that episode
because
we kept talking about your arms.
Because
and Kent got to play all of the organized team sports.
Yes,
and I ended up with all the preppy everything that was left.
Yeah,
yeah. And that was another double recording that, if I remember right, that was an Ask Baconsale and Baconsale Olympia.
So you guys all had that show
on
your top three.
Yes.
Yep.
All right, my last one is kind of a wild card.
Oh, but good.
Going back to listen to this one.
Good.
It is classic, and it shouldn't be because it's a bracket show, and it's hard to discriminate which part of the bracket is good and bad.
You kind of lump them together.
Right. But Disney Song Bracket Part 1 was wonderful,
you guys.
That was
a lot of fun.
Obviously, there's a lot of anger, but there's so many quotes here.
Yes, there was a lot of anger.
So, for example, I'm kind of bad-mouthing Simba a little bit, and you're like, you hate Lion King. You've always hated Lion King, and I hate you.
I did say
and
that.
And it felt honest.
Because I don't understand your hatred towards Lion King.
I don't hate Lion King. It's a masterpiece.
You say all the time, it's just Bambi.
It is just Bambi.
It's not Bambi.
It is. It's Bambi Hamlet. Let's be honest.
No.
Also, this is when I brought to everyone's attention, think of Batman Pooping Snakes.
Think of Batman Pooping Snakes. Which a lot of people, they resonated with them.
Yeah. Zack from Tangled singing, I got some dreams.
I got some dreams.
You got dreams.
Joel, you pushed try everything as hard as you could. And then you said to your kids, try everything. Except drugs.
I think it's a good message to teach them.
And then somehow in one of the blooper or the outtakes, and I put this at the end of the show, Zack and I are eating spaghetti like we're from Lady and the Tramp.
Yeah.
And we're making these kissing noises, why? Which is just adorable. Joel, you just had to watch that.
I did. And it was awkward for everybody. And
I don't know why, but the quotes in this episode are second to none. The singing was amazing too, because they're songs everyone knows and we perform poorly.
Yes. And I do enjoy that episode. That was a lot of fun to listen to. I love ones when we have clips in there too, musical clips.
All right, Zack, what do you got?
So I had Twitter Winner, I had Baconsalia, and then I threw in Queen Will Rock You, episode 306.
Joel, you did too.
Zack and I matched.
Yes,
3 for 3.
Wow.
I have Twitter Winner, I have Baconsalia, Summer Looks, and I have Queen Will Rock You.
What?
Starting off with Zach's amazing intro.
It was a fun intro. It was daunting, but it had to be done, and the band deserved it. And we went through the 70s bracket, and it was like this little, fake little deal, hey,
Led Zeppelin had to win.
Basically. Led Zeppelin has to win this. Yes. Queen is coming in second, but can we do a Queen show? Because this is the Led Zeppelin show. We went ahead and did the Queen show, and it was so rewarding.
Well, and Queen is always, I've always kind of put them in my favorite bands. Like one of my favorite bands, but because of the Greatest Hits Volumes 1 and 2, like that's
right.
That was exactly my Queen experience. So being able to go out there and listen to every single one of their studio albums, I felt like I accomplished something. That almost made my accomplishments. And then I discovered songs I love, like 39, I have listened to so many times now because I really, really enjoy that song. And it's so different from any other Queen song, but I really enjoy it. And then also just finding the dumb ones like Delilah.
Yeah.
About so Freddie Mercury writing a song about his cat, or us trying to very lightly touch on the song Don't Try Suicide because it's so corny and cheesy
so
and terrible.
So cheery, though.
I know. It's the weirdest thing. I just thoroughly enjoyed this song or this episode from start to finish. Yes. We started off with the Beach Boys one where we did that kind of format of the history of the band and then our favorite songs, and it worked so well for Queen, and I look forward to doing it to other bands in the future, but I'm really just like, man, that one really worked.
It's great.
Yeah.
So.
Wow. That's awesome. We had the same top three.
Yeah.
I love that.
I almost went with it, but I had to go.
I'm glad you did.
Yeah.
I'm glad you did too.
And I forgot how much fun that Disney bracket show was. Wow. Well, I guess that's it.
That's our look back at season seven. We hope you enjoyed that look back.
Guys, we really love ourselves, like a lot.
We do.
Apparently so.
We do.
But week in, week out, we put in some work.
Yeah.
We hope that you're able to bear with us. But as much as we love ourselves.
Yeah.
Do you know who we really love?
The listener.
The listener.
Yes.
And our patrons who help us every single year. We want to give them a shout out at the end of this show. We want to read every single patron name.
Yes, we're going to get through this as quickly as possible.
Little holiday present. Every active patron.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
I'll start off. Thank you to Devin Hansen, Spencer Thurman, Jeff Smith, Rachel Carlson, Spencer Larson, Steve Hamilton, Sean Purdy, Brandon Gehrig, Jill Reese, Joel Let's Go Chapik Jenkins, Paula Greenwell Mullis, Drew Maxfield,
Chase Hemingway, Mandy Schaefer, Natalie and Mark, Todd Callen, Heather Pease, Lori Sanquist, Rachel Allred, Ashley Hellstern, Evan Sanquist, Alicia Toner, Kendall Eliason, Jay Powell, Matt Edwards, Nathan and Chelsea, Brian and Angela Bass, Anna Bravo. Now, this is not a name, but I never thought it was such a bad little tree. It's not bad at all, really. Maybe it just needs a little love.
Aww.
Duncan Jewell and David Stewart.
Then we have our Tier 2 fans, which include Mikey Hales, A. Bake, Andrea Harrison, Ben Betts, Colton Cook, Eva Marie Pearson, Taylor Sanderson, Sam Ma, Shauna Elliman, Kimberly McEwen,
Valerie Ilguth, Adrian Vanderwecken, and Mary Cox.
Then we have our Tier 1 fans, which includes Crew Duttler, Chip, Angela Hammond, Jake Hunter, Johnny English, the Undying Six of the Nine, Brian Sorensen, Mitchell Stones, Andrew D., Christine Western, Verbis Vivum, Justified Ancients of Moo, Debbie Foster, Danelle Rowley, and Mike Henson.
And we have our I'm a Listener category with Scott Sprague, Sean Sandquist, Lady Terry Finley, Adam and Rachel Crump, Alicia Bass, Rocky and Steph, Bacon Council member Wannabe Kyler, Shannon West, Braden Winterton, Jennifer Kilkowski, Sir and Madam Hicks, Glow Clan Daniel, Allison Gall, Jake the Cooler King Swallow, and Casey Cummings.
And finally, we have our Bacon Council, which is Ryan and Marley Farron, Nicole Postal Elf number 29 Hale, Dead Chris Walking, Stephen Ross, Royal Highness Jessica Terry, our favorite couple, the Madsons, and Beaker.
Thank you, every one of you patrons.
Honestly.
And thank you, listener. We've said it before, but the show would be really dull if it was just us talking to ourselves. We'd entertain ourselves, but yeah, we wouldn't go anywhere after that. So we really do appreciate you listening to us, all those of you who've been here from the beginning and those of you who've recently joined us. We really, really, really do appreciate it.
Truly. Okay, guys, it's that time again.
Oh, you mean it's the time for the annual trailer for the upcoming season where we make up quotes on the spot during the recording, then force ourselves to use them in the following season, despite the fact that no one probably noticed that we were actually doing that?
Yes, that. Thanks, nice. Zack.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Kent, you're not going to travel through time or anything like that again, right? I mean, last time you did, bad things happened. Two words, worldwide pandemic.
Don't worry about that. Once again, Future Kent sent me a link. Hold on. Let me pull up my Hotmail.
Hotmail.
Hotmail. Mm-hmm. Surprised it's not a Yahoo. Or do you have your AOL open?
Whoa. Hey, Zack Youngin. AOL walked so Gmail could run. Hey, don't disrespect your elders, kid.
I had an AOL once.
Sorry for the wait. I found it. And here we go.
Does this silence mean the impending doom for 2022, Kent?
Dang it, the link isn't playing.
Oh, well, it looks like we're going to have to skip it, this yearly bit of planned predestination.
Hold on, Zack. There's a link here that might take me to another version.
Whoa, be careful of shady links, Kent.
Shady indeed. I'm now on some weird, like, torrents.
Oh, no.
Did you guys know there are singles in my area?
Stop. Don't click on any link on that page.
Kent, do you need help finding it?
Nope. I found it. Okay. Hold on. It's titled Baconsale Season 8 Trailer. Yeah, here it is.
Kent, that's not a B. That's an 8. It says Baconsale Season Trailer. That sounds, by nature, that sounds shady.
Baconsale? I love that.
No, that sounds bad.
Okay, the link took me here, so I'm sure future me just misspelled it, maybe? Or he's clever and wrote Baconsale?
No.
I'll just press this.
Nope.
And
no. Stop.
No.
Kent, what did you do?
I just pushed download.
Hold on. There's a glowing ball floating around in the corner of the room.
Yeah, it's getting bigger.
Someone's coming through.
Joel, it's you.
Oh, it's me, all right. Did you fools miss me?
What is going on?
That attitude. Oh, no. It's Joel 2016.
Huh?
This isn't good.
Another person hit, but I think it's another version of you, Kent.
Kent is just a weaker version of me. I'm the lovely and talented one.
Oh, man, it's Kenny D.
That must mean we're going to get another Zack.
Oh, here goes.
Adventure is out there.
Wow. That other me actually sounds kind of nice.
Yeah, he was nice. The other guys are jerks, but he sounds pretty nice.
Pleasant.
Well, the gang's all here. I am really excited about this.
Jake?
Thanks for taking the bait, Kent. I sent you that link. I heard that this dimension's Jacob left the show. In my world, I am the last man standing on the podcast. And what is Baconsale without me, honestly, and my clever wit? You guys are doomed without me. It was my masterful plan to combine the Baconverse.
Masterful plan? Since when does Jacob have a plan?
This is bad. The portal's getting larger. The Bacon Cave won't be able to sustain this many parallel dimensions combining.
Where am I? And who are you? Umbrella holding the...
Now we have a Joel who's not family-friendly? Could it get any worse?
Guys, Marvel thought of a multiverse long before you did. It was hilarious, and I loved it. I heart the MCU.
That's worse.
Look, I just love being entertained. Is that so wrong?
I'm gonna punch that me right in the slack jaw.
Kent.
Are you guys eating on the show? I would never do that.
Hey, can you come join us, other Zach?
Hey, no! There's nothing wrong with eating on the show.
I love the other Zachs.
No! Wait, Kent, there's more coming.
The portal won't close until your universe is destroyed and Bacon Cave Prime is complete. Here comes a few more friends.
Spencer, how could you do this? You're the listener.
I'm my world's reverse listener.
I'm the listener. Have been for years.
Where am I? Wait a minute. How did you guys get out of the snow globe?
Welcome to Baconsale. I'm Jolene.
I'm Kendra.
And I'm Zachary, with two E's.
Wait, there's a world with female versions of Baconsale? This multiverse stuff is madness.
Lady Me is pretty hot.
Stop.
Time to start smoldering.
Kent? No. No.
Please?
Guys, we need to focus. We have to find a way to stop the Baconsale multiverse from destroying our reality. All these different versions of ourselves can't exist in the same dimension. If this portal gets much bigger, then our world is...